وفي ده
ايه والله انا عندي غدا اللي خالد شيعان صديقي احمد من زمان
ما شاء الله
انت متعب بطل
عظيم.
مصر.
بسم الله، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، all thanks and praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may his peace and blessings upon his last and final messenger, his family, his companions, and those who follow him until the end of times. So alhamdulillah, last week we were able to explore the lessons and meanings of verses 47 through 50. And inshallah tonight the plan is to explore the lessons and meanings of verses 51 through 54, but we're going to cover verse 49 and 50 again. So just as a really quick reminder, in the last few verses that we covered, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us how the people of Quraysh rejected the Qur'an and refused to accept the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initially came to the people of Mecca and he started preaching the message of Islam, he started inviting them towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in belief in his existence and oneness, and he started inviting people towards worshipping him alone without any partners, and he started reciting Qur'an to them. Their initial response was rejection and opposition. So they responded with opposition, rejection, refusal, denial, and disbelief. And oftentimes they adopted this attitude of pride, arrogance, mockery, ridicule, and sarcasm. So we are told in verse number 48, "Now when the truth has come to them from us, they say, 'Why has he not been given the like of what Musa was given?' But did they not deny the truth of what Musa was formerly given? Indeed, they said these are two kinds of sorcery, each supporting the other, and they add, 'We reject both of them.'" So initially, again, their response is this objection, this rejection, this mockery, and this ridicule. And then in the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala poses a challenge to them, that if you refuse to accept the Qur'an or any other revealed scripture, then bring a book or message that is better in terms of guidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِكِتَابٍ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ هُوَ أَهْدَى مِنْهُمَا أَتَّبِعْهُ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Say, so bring a book from Allah that provides better guidance than these two, so that I may follow it, if you are indeed telling the truth. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's addressing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly, and he's telling him to respond to their opposition and rejection, respond to their arrogance, to their ridicule, to their mockery, with this particular question, with this particular challenge, that tell them to bring another book from Allah that provides better guidance than the Qur'an, that is more beneficial, so that I can follow it as well, if you are truthful in your claim. Now obviously this is a challenge, this is a question that they cannot respond to. This is a challenge that they cannot meet. There's no way possible for them to bring anything similar to the Qur'an in any way, shape, or form. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself provides the answer. And he says, فَإِن لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ. But if they do not respond to you, فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Then know that they are following their own desires. فَإِن لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ. Meaning they're not going to be able to answer this challenge. They're not going to respond to you. Then if that happens, فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Then know without a doubt that they are only following their own desires. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنِ اتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ بِغَيْرِ هُدًى مِّنَ اللَّهِ. And who could be more astray than one who follows his own desires without any guidance from Allah? إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Truly Allah does not guide those who are the wrongdoers. So the truth again is absolutely clear. The Qur'an is the divine, uncreated, eternal speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the guidance of humanity until the end of times. The Qur'an is beautiful, powerful, eloquent, and miraculous. Those who recognize this and know the truth deep down in their hearts, but still choose to reject the truth, are doing so because they prefer to follow their own whims and desires. Meaning the root cause for them rejecting the Qur'an, despite the fact that they recognize it's the truth, is that they want to follow their own ahwa. They want to follow their own desires, their own whims. They do not want to submit. And that, they say, is the essence of their disbelief. They simply do not want to submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincerity, with devotion, and servitude. So there are only two ways. Either commitment to the truth, which breaks the grip of desire and leads to submission and acceptance of true faith, or evading the truth and pursuing desire, which means rejecting the truth and denying faith. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if they don't respond to this challenge of yours, and of course they won't, then know that they are simply following their desires. And this is stated as an absolute fact from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that those who refuse to accept the truth are pursuing their own desires, whims, and self-interests. They have no excuse whatsoever. And after recognizing the truth, they have no sound argument or proof for continuing to turn away from that truth. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنِ اتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ بِغَيْرِ هُدًى مِّنَ اللَّهِ. That who in the world could be more astray than one who follows his own whims without any guidance from Allah? Meaning there's no one more misguided than that. There is no human being that is more misguided than a person who simply follows their own whims and desires and self-interests without any guidance, without any revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. That truly Allah does not guide those who are wrongdoers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He poses this rhetorical question in order to highlight that those who follow their whims and desires without any guidance from Allah are the most misguided people. And the concept of following one's desires and taking one's desires as something to be worshipped is extremely interesting. And this is something where we briefly discussed it last week, that the word hawa itself, it conveys several different shades of meaning. That the word hawa, it can mean love, it can mean affection, passion, inclination, liking, wish, desire, longing, craving, whim, and pleasure. And usually it refers to a person's unrestrained wants, desires, and thoughts. And that's what we're talking about here in the context of this particular verse. When we say ahwa, we are referring to a person's unrestrained wants, desires, and thoughts. And these ahwa, they are natural. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created within the human being certain wants and certain desires and certain whims that are an intrinsic part of human nature. These are normal, every single human being possesses them. It is the inclination of the self towards fulfilling its own self-interest. And every single human being has been created with some sort of wants, desires, and inclinations. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't want us to suppress them completely, nor does He want us to get rid of them completely. Rather, He wants us to control them, keep them in check, and limit them to certain boundaries. So we are allowed to act upon our whims and our desires and self-interests, but within certain boundaries that have been established by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those would be the boundaries of the Sharia, the boundaries established through the Qur'an and the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلْكَيِّسُ مَنْ دَانَ نَفْسَهُ وَعَمِلَ لِمَا بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ. The intelligent person is one who controls his desires and works for what's after death. وَالْعَاجِزُ مَنْ أَتْبَعَ نَفْسَهُ هَوَاهَا وَتَمَنَّى عَلَى اللَّهِ. And the non-intelligent person is one who allows his self to follow its desire and then has false hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this concept of following desires, it goes to the root of why people choose to disbelieve. It goes to the root of why people do not want to submit themselves to the will and command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why people choose to enjoy the life of this world instead of sacrificing pleasure for eternal pleasure in the life to come. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us elsewhere, أَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَى. That have you seen the one who has taken his own desires as a god? That the thing that they worship, the thing that they submit themselves to, the thing that they're committed to, is their own desires, their own self-interest. أَفَأَنْتَ تَكُونُ عَلَيْهِ وَكِيلًا. Can you be their guardian? أَمْ تَحْسَبُ أَنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ أَوْ يَعْقِلُونَ. Do you think that most of them hear or understand? إِنْ هُمْ إِلَّا كَالْأَنْعَامِ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا. They are just like cattle, No, rather they are further from the straight path. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is telling us that when a person allows their self to completely succumb to its desires, they end up becoming blind and deaf. They are unable to see and recognize the truth. And that's why there's a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he says, حُبُّكَ الشَّيْءِ يُعْمِي وَيُسِنْ. That your love for something causes you to become blind and deaf. Because when you're in love with something, you are unable to see its faults, its shortcomings, its deficiencies. So the same thing comes with our own personal interests and our whims and desires. When we fall in love with them and we're following them blindly, we will be unable to see its shortcomings, its deficiencies, and the problems associated with it. And Allah truly does not guide those who are wrongdoing. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And wrongdoing here refers to their disbelief, acts of disobedience, their rejection of prophets and messengers, and their denial of the truth, that they are not given the tawfiq to accept the truth and guidance. And the message has been delivered to them clearly, and they have no excuse for turning away from the truth and guidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 51, وَلَقَدْ وَصَّلْنَا لَهُمُ الْقَوْلَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. We have indeed caused this word of ours to reach them so that they may reflect. Right? وَلَقَدْ وَصَّلْنَا لَهُمُ الْقَوْلَ. We have indeed caused this word of ours to reach them, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ, so that perhaps they may reflect. So the word in this verse, al-qawl, right? The word al-qawl in this verse is referring to divine revelation. The words, the guidance and message of the Qur'an. Meaning the Qur'an has reached the people of Mecca gradually over time, giving them the chance and opportunity to think, reflect and ponder. Giving them the opportunity to accept the truth. And the Qur'an wasn't revealed all at once. It was revealed gradually over a period of 23 years. And it was revealed gradually in response to certain events, situations, questions, and circumstances. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed the Qur'an to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gradually according to His divine wisdom and plan. And part of that wisdom is that it allowed for the people of Quraysh to really absorb its message, to think, reflect, and contemplate over its teachings so that they could accept the truth. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Right? The Qur'an was made to reach them. The message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was made to reach them so that they had the opportunity to actually think and reflect and ponder over its message. Now the surah, it contrasts this attitude of rejection, denial, and opposition with one of acceptance and belief. And they say that this is part of the unique style of and beauty and eloquence of the Qur'an. That it allows us to compare and contrast both of these very different attitudes and approaches towards the truth and revelation. So these next few verses, they highlight the attitude and approach of those who sincerely look for the truth and try their best to follow it. And Sa'id ibn Jubayl, he mentions that these verses speak about 70 priests that were sent by Najashi. That when they met the Prophet ﷺ, he recited to them Surah Yasin from start to finish. They were in tears as they listened to it, and then immediately declared their belief in Islam. And these verses confirm what they did. And Muhammad ibn Ishaq, rahimahullah, he reports in his biography of the Prophet ﷺ the following narration regarding the background, the context of these particular verses. He writes, when the Prophet ﷺ was still in Mecca, some 20 Christians came to him after they had heard about him in Abyssinia. They found him in the mosque, and they sat with him asking him about his faith. A number of unbelievers from the Quraysh were sitting in their normal gathering places around the Kaaba. When the Christians finished their questions, the Prophet ﷺ called on them to believe in Islam and read some portion of the Qur'an to them. When they listened to the Qur'an, they were in tears. They immediately responded to the Prophet's call, declared their belief in Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was truly Allah's messenger. They confirmed that he met the description they had of him in their scriptures. When they rose to leave him, Abu Jahl and a number of the Quraysh unbelievers intercepted them and reprimanded them, saying, "How ill-advised are you? Your people sent you here to get information about this man, yet you hardly sat with him before you abandoned your faith and accepted his claims. We have never seen a more non-intelligent delegation than yours." So members of the delegation responded, We wish you peace, and we will not engage in futile argument with you. We follow what we choose, and you follow what you choose. We have not been slow to take advantage of the good that has been offered to us. Other narrations are also mentioned that are used to identify who exactly these verses are referring to. So the next few verses, verses 52 and 53 and 54, they are referring to a group from the people of the book who came to meet the Prophet ﷺ. And when the Prophet ﷺ invited them towards Islam, when he read the Quran to them, when he presented the message of Islam to them, they accepted it without any hesitation whatsoever. And because they accepted it without any hesitation, the people of Quraysh objected to that. And they ridiculed them, they mocked them, they made fun of them. And instead of responding to that mockery and ridicule, they responded with forbearance. They responded with strength and patience, and they responded with firmness. They said, "We wish you peace, that we're not going to engage in this useless debate and back and forth with you. We wish you peace, and we will not engage in useless arguments with you. We follow what we choose, and you follow what you choose. We have not been slow to take advantage of the good that has been offered to us." Now, regardless of who exactly these verses are speaking about, they are referring to a group of people from the people of the book, the Jews and Christians, that accepted the truth, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as soon as it was presented to them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verses 52 and 53, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ هُمْ بِهِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Those to whom we sent the book before this, believe in it. وَإِذَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِهِ إِنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّنَا إِنَّا كُنَّا مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مُسْلِمِينَ. And when it is recited to them, they say, "We believe in it, for it is the truth from our Lord. Truly, we were Muslims before it." So as we just discussed, these verses are referring to the people of the book, Ahlul Kitab, who believed in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they believed in their messenger, right? They believed in whatever they had learned in terms of religion and divinity and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approached them, they accepted his message without any hesitation whatsoever. So a group of individuals from the people of the book, Jews and Christians, that lived during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, accepted his message, recognized him as the promised and final prophet, and believed in the Qur'an. They recognized it as the truth because it reaffirmed their true beliefs in scripture. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this reality elsewhere in the Qur'an as well. So for example, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابَ يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِي أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Those to whom we have given the scripture, who follow it as it deserves to be followed, are the ones who truly believe in it. Those who deny its truth will be the ultimate losers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in Surah Ali Imran, وَإِنَّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَمَنْ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ خَاشِعِينَ لِلَّهِ لَا يَشْتَرُونَ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَرِيعُ الْحِسَابِ. That some of the people of the book believe in Allah, in what has been sent down to you, and in what was sent down to them, humbling themselves before Allah. They will never sell Allah's revelation for a small price. These people will have their rewards with their Lord. Allah is swift in reckoning. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ آمِنُوا بِهِ أَوْ لَا تُؤْمِنُوا إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ إِذَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ يَخِرُّونَ لِلْأَذْقَانِ سُجَّدًا وَيَقُولُونَ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّنَا إِنْ كَانَ وَعْدُ رَبِّنَا لَمَفْعُولًا. That say whether you believe in it or not, those who were given knowledge earlier fall down on their faces when it is recited to them and say, "Glory to our Lord, our Lord's promise has been fulfilled." And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gives us a description of their approach and attitude towards the Qur'an. So again, these verses are talking about a group of Jews and Christians who immediately accepted the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They recognized him as being the promised prophet who was described in their scriptures. They recognized that he was the last and final messenger sent for the guidance of all of humanity. And they recognized that the Qur'an was the last and final revelation. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes their attitude towards the Qur'an. وَإِذَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِهِ إِنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّنَا إِنَّا كُنَّا مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مُسْلِمِينَ. And when it is recited to them, they say, we believe in it, for it is the truth from our Lord. Indeed, even before this, we have been submitting ourselves to Him. So when the Qur'an is recited to them, they immediately recognize that it is the absolute truth from Allah. They accept this message and they believe in it. And part of the reason for that is because they were already believers from before. They had already submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in complete devotion, obedience, and servitude. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْتَوْنَ أَجْرَهُمْ مَرَّتَيْنِ بِمَا صَبَرُوا وَيَدْرَؤُونَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ السَّيِّئَةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. It is they who will be given their reward twice for having been patient in adversity, and they repel evil with good and spend from that which we have provided to them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's continuing to describe the good qualities of these individuals. First and foremost, they will be given double the reward. Right? أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْتَوْنَ أَجْرَهُمْ مَرَّتَيْنِ. That these Jews and Christians who accepted the message of the Prophet ﷺ will be given double the reward. And some say that the reward is given to them twice because they believed in the foretelling of the coming of Muhammad ﷺ and then accepted him when he was sent. It could also be because they accepted their previous prophet and then accepted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well. And it's narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari from Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, three categories of people will be given double reward. A man from the people of the book who believed in their prophet and then believed in me. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself is reaffirming this particular passage of the Qur'an. That anyone from the people of the book who was a true and firm believer in their religion, and then they accept the message of the Prophet ﷺ, they will be given double reward. Right? Similarly, the Prophet ﷺ said on the day of conquest, the conquest of Mecca, that whoever from the people of the book has accepted Islam, they will have double the reward. For them is what is for us, and upon them is what is upon us. So after praising them for their iman in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then praises and celebrates one of their unique qualities, which is a quality or characteristic unique to people of faith. وَيَدْرَؤُونَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ السَّيِّئَةِ. And they repel evil with good. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And they spend from that which we have provided to them. So they respond to evil with good. They do not reciprocate bad speech or behavior. And this is a very, very important quality or characteristic to have that is an expression of true faith and belief. So over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's describing one of their qualities, one of their attributes. And that quality and attribute is to not respond to bad behavior with bad behavior. Rather, it is to respond to bad behavior with pardon, with forgiveness, with mercy, with compassion and kindness. And this is perhaps one of the most difficult qualities to develop and nurture. Because all of us have experienced something like this. That there are instances where people will make us upset. They are going to say something, they are going to do something that pushes all of our buttons. That we are going to start feeling angry and upset. We're going to lose our temper. We're going to say things that we're going to regret. And we might even do things that we're going to regret. But at that moment, our faith, our iman requires us to be a better person. It requires us to control our temper, to control our emotions, and to not respond with negativity. Rather, we are supposed to respond with something that is much better. وَيَدْرَؤُونَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ السَّيِّئَةِ. That we respond to evil with good. And this is indeed harder than perseverance in the face of physical and mental hardship. So this is a quote from one of the Mufassirun. He writes that this attitude is indeed more difficult than perseverance in the face of physical and mental hardship. It means rising above personal pride and the desire to reply to ridicule and avenge physical injury. So when we respond with pardon, when we respond with forgiveness, when we overlook someone else's faults, someone else's mistakes, when we overlook their rude behavior, it requires us to swallow our pride. And that is perhaps one of the most difficult things to do. Because every single human being has this innate pride in them. That we don't like it when people put us down. We don't like it when people make us look unintelligent. Or we don't like it when people make us look bad in general. So this requires us to swallow our pride, swallow our arrogance. And the desire to reply to ridicule and avenge physical injury. It also entails rising a step higher and adopting a benevolent attitude so as to answer what is foul with that which is decent. So it requires being a better person. It requires having more forbearance, more patience, and adopting a benevolent attitude so as to answer what is foul with that which is decent. This is a height of greatness only achieved by good believers who feel that they are dealing with Allah and who look for His acceptance. So essentially he's saying that this type of attitude and this type of response can only come from a person of Iman. It can only come from a person who truly, truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they recognize that they're not dealing with the person in front of them, but the being they're actually dealing with is whom? With Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who's going to hold them accountable and hold them responsible and take care of that particular situation. Hence they forbear and persevere without losing their feeling of contentment. So they are also people of hilm. And that is what this quality is essentially called in the Arabic language. Hilm is the ability to have self-restraint and self-control, especially at the time of anger. Especially when we lose our patience. So you know, one of our teachers would say that patience starts when you lose your tolerance. Right? Being patient till your level of tolerance is not real patience. They say patience starts when you lose your tolerance. That's when you are required to have self-control and self-restraint. And self-control and self-restraint, first and foremost, has to do with our body language. It has to do with our tone of voice. But most importantly, it has to do with our speech. Because when we become upset, when we become angry, oftentimes our mind becomes clouded and our judgment becomes clouded. And we end up saying things or doing things that we're definitely going to regret later on. And that's why there are so many ahadith in which the Prophet ﷺ teaches us and encourages us to learn how to control our emotions and our temper. That, you know, the Prophet ﷺ, one of the companions came to him. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, O Sini, that O Messenger of Allah, give me some advice. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, La taghdab, don't get angry. So again, the companion asked, you know, give me some more advice. And the Prophet again said, La taghdab, don't get angry. And he repeated this 3 times. So later on, the companion said that, you know what, at first, I did not recognize the significance of this advice. But later on, after reflecting upon it, I realized that the Prophet was telling me to control something that will be a barrier between me and several different acts of disobedience. It will be a barrier between me and several things that I might regret later on. So the Prophet ﷺ is saying, he's not saying don't get angry, because anger is a natural human emotion. It's a natural human response. Every single human being becomes upset and angry. But what we're being told to do is control that anger, to channel it in the right direction. Right? In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, لَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِالسُّرْعَةِ, that shadid, the strong person, is not the one who can overpower you physically. A strong person is not one who can overpower you physically. وَلَكِنَّ الشَّدِيدَ الَّذِي يَمْلِكُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَدَمِ. But a true strong person is one who can control himself when they are angry. Right? And similarly, the Prophet ﷺ says that مَنْ كَظَمَ غَيْظًا وَهُوَ قَادِرٌ عَلَىٰ إِنْفَاذِهِ. That whoever swallows their anger, despite having the ability to act upon it, مَلَأَ اللَّهُ قَلْبَهُ أَمْنًا وَإِيمَانًا. Allah fills that person's heart with peace, with security, with contentment, and with faith. So that's one of the beneficial consequences of striving and struggling to control our temper, to be people of hilm, to have self-restraint and self-control. And that's one of the qualities being described here. وَيَدْرَؤُونَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ السَّيِّئَةِ. And the last thing that's mentioned, وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And they are also extremely generous. And they say that these two types of generosity, the personal and the financial, spring from the same origin. One which makes a believer rise over personal desire so as to treasure what is higher than earthly values. And both are often mentioned together in the Quran. So essentially this commentator, this Mufassir, he's saying that hilm, that being overlooking and pardoning and forgiving, is also a form of charity. That when you are controlling your temper and your anger, and you're forgiving someone, and you're overlooking their faults, and you're pardoning them, that's a type of charity. Just like giving physical charity as well. And both of them come from the same place. Both of them come from the iman that lies within our hearts. So we are out of time. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give all of us the qualities of these believers, to give us hilm and to give us generosity, to make us people who are able to control our temper and who respond to evil with goodness and who overlook and pardon and forgive people's faults, and to also make us people who are extremely generous with not only our wealth but with our time and our knowledge and our abilities as well. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this from us. وصلى اللهم على نبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين